traveling.
Live from Toronto to the world.
Josh! Josh! Josh!
This is Josh Holiday Live. Talk that rocks.
The public needs to be informed.
Josh might surprise us.
Got an opinion? Dial 647-6-YO-JOSH.
When you hear him, you're like, what?
Josh Holiday Live starts now.
Oh, hey there. It's me. Your lovable buddy, Josh. We are live in 2023, the first show of a brand new year. Hope your holidays were well. You had a good time. This week, I am going to speak with a documentarian. There's a documentary premiering tonight at Toronto's Hot Docs Cinema near Bathurst and Bloor. I'm a regular, a member of that place. The documentary actually debuted last year in its Francophone version in Quebec and was the most popular documentary of the year there and has already climbed into the top 10 documentaries of all time in Quebec. The English version is out at the Hot Dog Cinema this week. Through the weekend, a number of showings, and it's going to open wide to more locations and more cities this year. So keep your eye out for that. The documentary is called Backlash, Misogyny in the Digital Age, and it's about online hate directed towards women, which is an epidemic. Spoke to the co-director, Guylaine Maroist. And this is how that conversation went. The documentary has already come out in Quebec and has been quite popular and has actually inspired action. I watched it last night, and the main feeling I came away with was frustration. And I think most of the frustration came from the lack of consequences for the bad actors in most of the stories in the film. So I think my first question is, why do you think that law enforcement is so reluctant to pursue action on some of these incidents?
Well, you know, you're right. The problem is that we don't punish aggressors on the internet. And the problem is not necessarily the law, because you cannot threaten anyone by the law. You know, you cannot have rape threats or death threats. If you were to come in my home and do these things to me, you know, we would go to the police and, you know, you would have to stop. The problem is that when women who are threatened go to the police, most of times the police says, well, sorry, it must be terrible, but we cannot protect you. And they don't retain the complaint there. And so the process of going through a trial and punishing the person, et cetera, so it doesn't go along, because at the very first moment, the woman's situation is banalized, because, you know, even today, there's this myth that the virtual world, the online world, is not as threatening as the real world. When we know now, you know, we spend a lot of our lives online. It has become our public life. You know, the social media is part of our public lives. So we still need to stop banalizing this phenomenon. And I think that's why Leah and I, Leah Clermont-Dion, the co-director, with myself, when we were doing this film and following these women, that's what we realized, that, wow, you know, that's the first problem. And we have to stop that. So there's a petition going online where we're asking our governments to give the police officers a formal training. It doesn't have to be a long training. Just watch the film and people would stop banalizing, you know. We need to raise awareness on these issues.
Mm. Yeah, I know there's an effort in some law enforcement agencies to tackle cybercrime, but it's not necessarily online hate. It's more fraud and those types of things. There are four main stories within the film, and one of the stories features a group of university students, a group of young women in university, and there's someone in their class initially sending anonymous hate messages to them, you know, encouraging them to shut up, but then it escalates, it gets worse. At first, they don't know who this is coming from, where it's coming from, but eventually they realize specifically who this one guy in their class is. And again, we talked about the inaction of it, but I couldn't help feel a little haunted by where it was taking place, and the similarities to the Polytechnique massacre from years ago. I was like, oh my God, this is like, it's basically a modern day version of that, and it's not being taken seriously. And it I think there's a significance to the fact that the film is based in Montreal and in Quebec, and especially that story.
You're right. You know, you're the first person who mentions this. We didn't do this on purpose, but it just happens that, you know, our four stories, there's one in Quebec. The other stories, we have, we're following a politician in Italy, Laura Boldrini, another politician, a black woman in Vermont, Kaya Morris, and also a French YouTuber, Marion Seclin. So this story in Montreal, we're following this young teacher, and we realized that she's being threatened. She thinks girls from her classroom are sending her insults and are telling her basically to shut up. But then she realizes that you're speaking with other girls, that other girls are also being threatened. And it escalates, as you say, and they came to realize that there was about 30 women threatened, as you know, that actually have filed complaints to the police in a period of 5 years. And you're right, it happened very close to Polytechnique, you know, physically. These campuses are not very far from one another. We wanted with Laurence to also follow an anonymous woman, because we you know, in the past recent years, we know that women politicians are targets, women who speak in the public space, journalists, feminists, you know, are the first targets of misogynists online. But there are also all these anonymous women, but who also, you know, we realized doing all these interviews, because we selected these four stories, but we spoke to actually 100 people to the research of this film. And we realized that, you know, targeted women are women who speak loud and who have a voice, who are different. And the Polytechnique event, Marc Lépine was targeting feminists, and he thought, oh, okay, there are women wanting to be engineers. This is a problem, so we're going to start by eliminating these women. But he wanted to kill feminists. The guy who has threatened Laurence and her colleagues did not also like women who have a strong voice. So that's the similarity, unfortunately. But you can see this everywhere now in the Western world, unfortunately.
Yeah, it was unfortunate. There was a classroom scene with young girls who, even then, some of them have experienced this kind of online hate and harassment. It was really
Children.
Yeah, it was disappointing as an understatement, but yeah, it was nice. And then I was also gained more frustration, not just with the police, but in a university setting, that the university wouldn't act upon the information they had on this guy. Is there any update on him? Obviously, he doesn't get identified specifically in the film, but has he faced any consequences?
Well, you know, because there were so many complaints filed by women, at one point, one judge decided to order him to stay away from a computer for a year, I think. But when the year ended, he started again.
Oh, I'm sure. And,
Yeah, sure. And now that when the film came out in October in Quebec, Laurence started to be targeted again. We presume that it's him because it's the signature of his. It's you know, it's the same signature of messages and the type of threat. And he clearly threatens her her life. You know, in these recent, so we went to the police, and unfortunately, again, the police officer said, "We're sorry, we cannot do anything, and just buy a camera to try and," and there was, you know, an article, a journalist followed this story, and it was published in December, about the fact that how come, and the response, the answer to that, how come, it's because they banalize the phenomenon.
If you're just tuning in, we are speaking with documentarian Guylaine Maroist. She is the co-director of Backlash, Misogyny in the Digital Age. It's playing all this weekend at the Hot Dog Cinema in Toronto, and we'll play in other cities after that. The conversation continues in just a moment.
You all know that thing you use to send text. It works for actual mouth talking.
Josh stuff.
Get in on the conversation. Punch 647-6-YO-JOSH to be heard. Talk that rocks. Josh Holiday live.
Yes, live in the new year, 2023. Continuing our conversation with Guylaine Maroist, she is the co-director of Backlash, Misogyny in the Digital Age, a documentary playing all this weekend at the Hot Docs Cinema in Toronto. This is how the conversation went.
It's sort of frustrating to see for years and years and years such progress for women's rights and feminism.
Yes.
And it almost feels like the internet has stepped in the way of that progress, and particularly the anonymity of the internet. Although even when the characters are identified or exposed, there's no real consequences. Not just the internet, but the age of Donald Trump. I think has emboldened a lot of people who might otherwise stay in the dark. How much of an effect do you think the Donald Trump presidency has had on the hate towards groups, but women in particular?
I think he's kind of a symptom. You know, he's not necessarily the reason, but he unleashed something ugly in people's behaviors. You know, when you have the president of the United States and all this episode of, you know, pussy grabbing and, you know, this, I don't know how to say it, but clearly, and also racism, you know, he unleashed, you know, you can see it everywhere in the U.S. And the rise of the so-called alt-right, it's a true phenomenon. And the problem is now there are younger men who are becoming popular with these sexist and misogynistic rhetoric that is being propagated in the you know, on the social media. You've heard about Andrew Tate, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. But, you know, he's immensely popular with the younger generation. We're talking billions of views on TikTok, billions. So it's incredible. So this is dangerous because, as you said, you know, there has been a real progress in women's rights, particularly in our country. You know, we could you know, have high hopes for equality, but it's kind of now there's a movement, there's kind of a backlash. That's why the film is called Backlash. That happens with technology when the promise of the internet was to give more democracy, more power, to more diversity as well, you know. There's this movement, and we have to be careful because these are real threats. You know, sometimes we think because we are in our own bubbles on our social media, we kind of think these things don't exist, but they are there, and they're growing rapidly. And, you know, what we started working on this film, Leia and I, 7 years ago. And unfortunately, we have witnessed the growth of this phenomenon. And, you know, at first, you know, when we started investigating this phenomenon, the term cyber violence, I think, did not even exist. So we live in another world, you know. These 7 years have been incredible for all of us. Mm. But, and unfortunately, the pandemic has, there are studies who demonstrate that the number of attacks towards women, the misogyny, the sexist rhetoric is really growing.
Mm. Well, that's the thing. A lot of times the women who are being threatened are sort of told, well, it's just a threat, you know, just try and ignore it and keep aware. But years ago, personally, I remember I had some threats to the level where I had to get the police involved. And even after they were involved, you're still always kind of hyper aware and it's not any kind of way to live, having in the back of your head, okay, looking around, always, you can't really be free. And so watching these women and what they have to go through is really frustrating. And it's not like there's not real life examples of these kind of misogynistic attacks coming to fruition. We look at there's a van attack in Toronto. There's a number of basically incel attacks in the U.S. and there's a real incel movement. Involuntarily a celibate is how they describe themselves. They feel that they're owed attention and sex by women. And again, you mentioned Andrew Tate, who I guess more since the film's come out has become more not just popular, but certainly come to more people's attention. Then you have Jordan Peterson, who's sort of the coddler of the incels. And there is a real right-wing movement of like, well, you know, women are sort of, we'd like to go back to the days where the men are the masculine and the women are sort of secondary citizens and stay in the kitchen. And I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that the right-wing movement has grown under Trump. And there are these figures now where these young men can kind of idolize these gross idols. It's epidemic. And the film came out in Montreal last year, and you know, even in the short time since it's come out, Elon Musk has decided that he's going to reopen Twitter to all kinds of hate without any kind of filtering. And he's kind of gotten in bed with these right wingers and has posted similar memes. So it's almost like you have the richest guy in the world is also a giant troll and women hater. So it's incredible.
It is. And I think, you know, we have to be aware, you know, the incels, it's, I was speaking a couple of months ago to a person in counter-terrorism in the U.S., And they are, you know, they have to try and find these people online and try to prevent these attacks. And they have dismantled a lot of them. You know, that it's great that they're there to do the job. But this person was telling me that it's growing. And it's, you know, for them to have teams that watch, that try to find these groups, you know, all the time. You know, it's something real. There's real preoccupations. I think we have to be aware and we have to do things to change these things. And, you know, I was talking before about this, training police officers is one thing to do, but education, in the very young crowd, we need to have a discussion about, you know, the digital citizenship. Mm. We have civilized our world. We have to civilize also the social media, because it is our world now. And the problem with the social media platforms is that they can leave this, actually, they kind of like this heinous content because it generates likes, shares, and that's what they're all about. You know, that's in their business model. So if they're not obligated to remove these contents, they will not do it.
No.
And now they're kind of above the law, you know, because there are these international super corporations. But we need to make laws and demand that they remove this content. Mm. And the technology is there. It's not true that we don't have the technological tools to remove rapidly these contents, you know. And so Germany has been at the avant-garde and made such a law. It's been promulgated in 2019, and they're having success, you know. Like Facebook has to remove within 24 hours the heinous content, and if they do not, they pay substantial fines, like 50 million euros. Mm-hmm. So I think we need to do these things.
Yeah, I think in general, Europe seems to be a little bit more proactive in trying to regulate the internet, and it's a little frustrating mm-hmm. here to see how much there's a lack of willingness to do that. And as you said, the content doesn't just get stopped because it gets people to watch it, but in a lot of cases the algorithms feed more of this information. So if someone follows some hateful account and is interested in that, YouTube or Twitter will feed them more of that and pull them further and further into that group. So it really is a big problem. And you mentioned Facebook, and I thought it was interesting that in your documentary you feature Mark Zuckerberg's sister, in an interview. And I'm just wondering, how did that come about, and how did you get in touch with her and her views?
Well, I read an article because she had published a book. I think it's 2018 or 19. She published a book called Not Only Dead Men, Not Only Dead White Men, Misogyny in the Digital Age. And it's very interesting because Donna Zuckerberg, the sister of Mark, is the only person in this family who doesn't work in the Silicon Valley technology. She's the intellectual and she studies the classics. Mm. And she realized, because she publishes a very niche blog on the classics, and so their articles are viewed by just a couple of tens of 100 people to the maximum. And at one point, one of the articles were shared thousands of times. And she said, oh, my God, what's happening? You know, like suddenly the American people are going into the classics. And actually, all this alt-right wing movement in the U.S., a lot of them are kind of fascinated by the classics. Why? Because in their opinion, you know, the Western civilization is going down the drain. And why is it going down the drain? Because women and, you know, black people, for instance, are in power. And look at, you know, the birth of democracy, the birth of the Western civilization, you know, in ancient Greece, women and black people were slaves, basically. So they kind of like to make citations of
and romanticize it as well.
What?
And romanticize that, yes. That era.
Actually, yes, romanticize.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, Steve Bannon does that, for instance. You know, yeah. Steve Bannon, who used to be the advisor of Donald Trump, but now who has turned into this advisor of all the right-wing movements in Europe.
Pro-fascism, you know? Basically.
Yeah, fascist, actually, yes, to say the real words.
Yeah, it's a crazy world. And yeah, I think even in Donald Trump's platform, Make America Great Again, it's sort of hint, you know, don't say it too loudly, but, you know, we want to go back to a time where you know, men were in power and women were sort of subservient, and the whole movement's built around that. And there's been tons of subgroups that have come from sort of that right-wing movement of incels and, you know, pro-masculinity. You know, we want to start our own compounds where the men are the men, and it is frightening. And I'm not sure how we tie this up, but you know, we've talked about,
you know, you were talking about Donna Zuckerberg, you know, and that's exactly, you know, she started researching all these people who were talking about the classics, and she kind of mapped all these masculinists online. And that's what her book is about, you know, all these different groups, men's rights activists, you know, there are all kinds of groups. You know, the mildest probably are the men's rights activists, to the incel, you know, all this manosphere, or there are different terms to designate these people. And but that's how she got interested in this. And that's very interesting that she realized that probably the biggest threat to women's rights was the social media now, you know.
What's her relationship with her brother? You know, it feels like philosophically they're at odds, but does she have a relationship with Mark Zuckerberg?
I think she does, because you know, yeah, I went to her home, and she lives in Palo Alto in Silicon Valley, and she seems to have a good relationship. She didn't want to address this specifically, you know, probably because it's a sensitive family issue, and she doesn't want to speak against her brother, probably. But you know, I'm just assuming. But she was talking about the social media in general, which actually, you know, implies Facebook, which is the biggest one on the planet still. They must have interesting discussions in family gatherings. But she's very, very clear about that.
Well, it's somewhat of a relief to know that there's someone in his inner circle who maybe has his ear to a small extent.
Yeah.
And I think certainly this year he's got a lot of cover by the acquisition of Twitter by Elon Musk. Facebook sort of, you know, they've been able to kind of hide in the shade, but it happens on all social media. But to see the extent that the richest man in the world, or maybe now second richest, because he's failed in a number of ways recently financially, which is nice to see some consequence. But yeah, it's almost like the flag bearer for that movement is the head of one of the biggest social media companies in the world.
Yeah.
And I wonder if you have any ideas. We've talked about online regulation. What other solutions do you think there are?
Well, you know, I think you know, we have to make laws, and this specific law, I think, has to be made, and we have to, the people in everywhere, but I'm thinking about Canada, we have to be behind it. And, you know, and that's what we hope to do with the film, to raise awareness on this issue, because people hear about it. We've been hearing about cyber violence, about these threats for a couple of years. But, you know, we read articles and we tend to banalize, and we tend to not see that it has become a democratic issue. Mm. And that, and I was teaching at UQAM University here in Montreal, and last year, you know, I was an invited professor, and I was talking about the film I was making, and one girl told me at one point, oh, yes, we know about, you know, these threats. And she says, for instance, I wanted to go in politics, but I decided not to go in politics because I don't want to live this type of life. And this is, it's horrific to hear that it became just an automatic way of reasoning to say, oh, okay, I'm not going to express myself in a political way, not become a politician, or I'm not going to express myself on sensitive issues on social media platforms because that's what I'm going to experience. This makes no sense.
No.
And you see, and so we have to raise this awareness. And what we in, you know, the film, when it was released here, it had a tremendous success in Quebec. All the, you know, the media really spoke about it. We went to the National Assembly, Leah and I, and it had incredible media coverage. People are behind, and people showed up to the theaters. We were number one at the box office for the whole year. You know, so people showed up. People want to have the discussion. It's kind of timely. Mm. And we hope that people will show up, will go see the film, and want to go be behind these initiatives, education, you know, try to have a real program of, you know, digital citizenship. I don't know how you say that in English, but, you know, to raise awareness at a very early age, first to protect the children, but also to tell them the consequences of these threats, because they're not aware when they insult people, you know, when they start very young to insult them, their colleagues, they're not aware it's a crime. Mm-hmm. They're not aware of the psychological impact they have on the other people. So, you know, they have to learn, and we have to, yeah, so education is very important and change, raise awareness in all the, I don't know how you say that, but the judiciary system, yeah. starting from the police to the judges, because the law is there, but then we have to interpret the law and, you know,
enforce it. Yeah. And you did mention,
yeah,
you mentioned there is a woman who was dissuaded from going to politics. And I should mention that in the documentary, not only do we talk about the young woman in school in Montreal, but there's a politician in Rome where there's a crazy amount of misogyny, but just it's a whole different world politically over there, and it's surprising how yes. open the misogyny is. And then there's a woman in Vermont who is not just a woman but a black woman who has to deal with these misogynists in a very white state. And and again, it goes to your point where these actions, these misogynistic actions, and are actually having an effect on people, making them change their life path. So it's what they want, and it's actually yes. happening. So how do we stop that? It's a really, really eye-opening documentary, and hopefully more and more people see it, and there's some results, and people finally face some consequences for bad actions.
Yes.
Yeah. We can hope, but thanks so much for coming on and having a chat about it. And
well, thank you, Josh. And you know, when you say, well, I hope people will, you know, it will go see the film. And I'm very optimistic. You know, we have to be optimistic, and we have to. We live in a good society. You know, we cannot let things go backwards. We have to be all behind this and fight. There are huge fights to be had in the next couple of years, and we have to have them, and we have to be hopeful.
That is Guylaine Maroist. She is the co-director of a documentary called Backlash, Misogyny in the Digital Age, and it is playing all weekend at the Toronto Hot Dog Cinema, and we'll expand after that showing. It is Josh Holiday Live, and we're going to come back and do something a little lighter in just a sec. We will tell you the rudest things you can do in someone else's house.
Something bugging you? Need a vent?
Where the f*** is Josh?
This is your unfiltered megaphone.
When you hear him, you're like, what?
Dial 647-6-YO-JOSH now to be heard. Talk that rocks. Rocks. Josh Holiday Live.
Yep. Live. Josh Holiday Live. How are you? Happy New Year. Although I don't think you're supposed to say Happy New Year after the first week of January. I think it's etiquette rules against that. What are some of the rudest things you can do in someone else's house? I know I'm guilty of some of these. Expecting a tour. Many people are fine to show you around, but don't go to someone's house expecting them to give you a tour. Overstaying your welcome. This is a big one. Know when it's time to leave, especially if you're at a party or something. If the hosts start getting their pajamas on and they start making broad hints about, oh boy, I think we're going to go to bed soon, get the hell out. Hiding a mess. So say you accidentally break something or spill something. Don't try to hide it. Mistakes happen. You can tell your host. Maybe embarrassing. Maybe you clog the toilet. Ask for a plunger. Don't just leave the stuffed toilet. And if you break something, don't just disappear it. You're going to drive people crazy psychologically because they'll be like, wait a second, I know I had this thing here. Where is it? Bringing an uninvited plus one. If someone invites you to their house, they don't want a surprise extra guest that you bring along. They might be amenable to it, but the best thing to do is check ahead of time. Make sure that the guest is going to be okay. Some of the other ones, waiting to share dietary restrictions. So you go to someone's house for dinner. And when the dinner comes out, it's a big, a big steak or something. You're like, oh, yeah, I should have mentioned, but I'm a vegetarian. Sorry about that. Do you have something else I could eat? Just tell people ahead of time. Everybody has dietary things these days. It's not a huge deal, but how you deal with it is important. Don't feed the animals unless you know specifically that it's okay or the food is okay for them to eat. No matter how cute the dog is. I know my dog, Boise, the beagle, he has eyes that will pierce you. He will stare at you with those brown eyes until you obey, you give in to his will. I've learned to resist. Although it's very difficult, mostly he stares at me because he wants me to play with him. And eventually I relent and we run around the house. But yeah, don't feed dogs. respect the rules of the house when it comes to shoes. I always just assume shoes off unless I'm told otherwise. And we can get into a whole discussion about wearing shoes in houses. I used to be like, yeah, wear your shoes around, but now I'm aware that I'm in dog parks. Sometimes I'll find poop on my shoes, and rather than maybe not notice and drag that poop around, and then I spend a lot of time in my own place in my bare feet, and I think, well, wait a second. Sometimes I'm dragging dirt in here, and then it's in my bare feet. Am I going to get a ringworm? That's the conclusion I jumped to. And if you're going to visit someone's house, whether it's a dinner, housewarming, you're a guest of some kind, you're staying there, bring some sort of, whether it's a gift or if it's a dinner party, maybe a dessert, or don't come empty-handed is the rule. And the one that I sometimes break is the touching and moving things. When people say make yourself at home, they don't really mean it literally. Keep your feet off the furniture. Don't open the fridge without being asked. Don't poke around in people's medicine cabinets. The area where I sometimes mess around, and it's a goodwill gesture, really, but I probably shouldn't do it. A lot of the modern televisions, your LEDs, your LCDs, your 4K TVs, your pretty soon 8K TVs, a lot of them come preset with the motion smoothing on. So what this means is the picture comes from your source, your cable, your DVD, your whatever, your Netflix, and these TVs are set to automatically make the motion even smoother. So they do it digitally. It's great for sports because it makes it clear, especially if there's fast motion. But what happens when you're watching more artistic stuff like movies or television shows is something called the soap opera effect. So you're watching even a classic movie like I don't know, The Godfather or something, and it looks suspiciously like the lighting is like a soap opera. It's too real. It's like hyper-realistic. Well, a lot of that has to do with a setting on the television, and it's called different things under different television brands. And if you want to fix it, just Google soap opera effect, and you can find instructionals on the assorted different televisions on how to turn that feature off. But I can't help myself if I'm at someone's house and I put their TV on and it's the soap opera effect. I can't help from going into their settings, their picture settings for the television, and fixing it for them. I can't help it. It's too weird to seeing the... But some people get defensive about it. They think, oh, wow, I can't believe like how clear the picture is. It's amazing how realistic it is. It's almost like a documentary camera is there. But the filmmakers and the people who make these programs, they don't want it seen that way. They intended it to be seen as it was produced and not how your TV smooths out the motion in it. And it's even become an issue for some films. Lord of the Rings came out a number of years ago, and people were saying it's because of it was shot in 4K and the frame rate is high. It looks too realistic. It doesn't really feel fantastical. It feels just sort of fake. And similar complaints have been launched more recently with the sequel to Avatar, where there's a bit of a mishmash. Some of the scenes look soap opera-ish and fake, and some of them look more realistic. I think what filmmakers are doing now are using the motion smoothing and the more clear picture for fast-moving action sequences and for the more regular, more intimate scenes. They're not using the hyper-realistic frame rate and digitalization, is that a word? Sort of. Not the way I pronounce it, though. So, yeah, when I go to people's house, I change the motion smoothing. And I was actually relieved. I just bought I replaced my television recently. Got for LG OLED. Oh, I love it. But they have, in their picture setting modes, you can actually select filmmaker mode, which means that it doesn't add any of the artificial settings at all. It just plays the media as it comes into the television as the filmmakers intended. And there's a few other little settings where you can select sports mode. So almost all of the time I have it on filmmaker mode, but when I watch the Leafs games, as I do all the time, I switch it over to sports mode, and it's brighter and a little bit more sharp. So yeah, there's some television advice for you in this new year. It is a Josh Holiday Live, the radio program. We are here every Friday from 3 to 4, and you can get past episodes of this particular broadcast at joshholidaylive.com. You can also find all kinds of information on the show at that site. Get in contact. If you want me on Twitter, it's at Josh Holiday, two L's in Holiday. If you're looking on Instagram, I have at Unfunny. And for all the other information, you can visit the radio station website, which is SAUGA960AM.ca. So many ways to get in touch. And the one we always like is, of course, the phone number. If you call 6476-YO-JOSH, we can pick up your call and have a chitter chatter, though the show is winding down. So you're not going to talk to us live today. But here's the good part is that number is active 24/7, 7 days a week. You can leave a message there. If you call at like 2, 3 in the morning, that's okay. You're not going to wake anybody up. But you can leave your thoughts, your complaints, your compliments, whatever you have, you can leave it there. Anyway, have a good week.
Turn on the lights, open the shades.
The show's over, but the conversation continues. On Twitter at Josh Holiday, on the web at joshholidaylive.com, and hear missed episodes on your favorite podcatcher. Talk that rocks. Josh Holiday Live.